Okay, so parasitology is another branch of microbiology which is important for entrance. Recently, it is increasingly asked. The reason is image based MCQs. The image based MCQs are so much from parasitology, that is why the number of questions are relatively more nowadays. But it is not a difficult topic, it is a light headed topic. So, whenever you are feeling bored, you can open parasitology and read, and it is not very difficult. So, general parasitology you can read by yourself. I will start from individual topics. So, let us start with amoeba. Amoeba broadly, they are categorized into intestinal amoeba and free living amoeba. Intestinal amoeba pathogenic is Entamoeba histolytica. Non-pathogenic is Entamoeba coli, and also there are various other non-pathogenic amoeba are available. Free living I will discuss a bit later. So, now let us start Entamoeba histolytica. So, histolytica, any parasite when we discuss, if you talk about the life cycle, then there are certain questions you have to answer first. That is, what is the habitat of the parasite? What is the infective mode, infective form? Which is the diagnostic form? Which is the pathogenic form? Which is the mode of transmission of the parasite? So, these are the questions which should be answered first, then only it is easy to discuss the life cycle, or even the summary of the life cycle will be this question what they can ask. As far as Entamoeba histolytica is concerned, you know that it is a large intestinal parasite. The habitat is large intestine, and it has two forms are there, trophozoid and cyst. Infective form is what? Cyst also will have immature cyst, that is immature cyst will have one or two nucleus, mature cyst will have four nucleus. So, which is the infective form? Yes, quadrinucleated cyst. So, the quadrinucleated cyst, of course, mode of transmission will be fecal mode, following which the quadrinucleated cyst in the small intestine will undergo excystation. When it undergoes excystation, trophozoids will be released. Trophozoids, they go to large intestine, and as I told you, large intestine is the habitat of Entamoeba histolytica. They usually reside in the large intestine. In the large intestine, the trophozoid, when they go, trophozoid will have virulence factor on its surface which are called as lectin antigen. These lectin antigens are the adhesins of the trophozoid by which the trophozoid are adherent to the large intestinal mucosa, and that leads to various pathogenesis. So, if they ask which is the pathogenic form, trophozoid or cyst, answer is trophozoid are the pathogenic form because they contain the virulence factor, they express the virulence factor called as lectin antigen by which it bind to large intestinal wall, and following which it can cause all the pathogenic process in the intestinal wall that leads to formation of flask shaped ulcer in the intestinal wall. Granuloma formation, which is called as amoeboma. Amoeboma is a type of granuloma formation, and further multiplication leads to invasion of trophozoid. Invasion of trophozoid can cause GI perforation also, sinus formation and perforation. through which the trophozoite can invert, and they migrate to extra intestinal site, which is the most common extra intestinal site, liver. So, which is the pathogenic form? Answer is trophozoite. Which is the invasive form? Answer is again trophozoite. Which form goes to liver? Again trophozoite. In liver, which forms are seen? Trophozoite, cyst, or both? Answer is only trophozoite, because cyst is never formed inside the tissue. Cyst is formed in the favorable or unfavorable condition? Unfavorable condition. Inside the body, always you will have a favorable condition. So, trophozoites will be attached to the GI wall, and they want to come out of the body. They come to the lumen, and the lumen they will be transformed to cyst. Cyst initially will have immature cyst, gradually they will form tetranucleated mature cyst. And as far as the release in the feces is concerned, feces, both immature and mature cyst are released, and cyst are the usual diagnostic form. Cyst are the usual diagnostic form. Most of the time cyst will be released, immature and mature. But which is the infective form? Only mature. That means what happens to immature cyst? Immature cysts, once they are released in the environment, they will become mature cysts, or they will get disintegrated. Yes, they cannot, immature to mature cyst can occur only inside GIT. Once they come out, they will be disintegrated. Okay. So the usual infective usual diagnostic form is cyst. Most of the time cyst will be there. But the thing is, cyst, if it is present, you cannot differentiate whether the infection is active or not. Most of the cases cyst will be there in carriers only. It cannot differentiate the disease is in active stage or not. Once in a while, very very rarely, the trophozoites also can directly be seen in the feces. Presence of trophozoite, though it is rare, but it indicates, it confirms active infection. Okay, so this is what you have to remember. So carriers are the, cysts are the routine diagnostic form, but they indicate carrier state. They cannot differentiate active and carrier in stage. Whereas trophozoites are released once in a while, but if they are present, they confirm the active infection. Okay, so this is all about. Then regarding the lab diagnosis is concerned, say that stool examination is done, and you take at least 3 consecutive stool sample. And if you do a stool microscopy, how the cyst and trophozoites they appear? They say that you have to differentiate the cyst and trophozoite of Entamoeba histolytica with that of Entamoeba coli, because Entamoeba coli is the most common commensal in your GIT, and often it will be confused with Entamoeba histolytica. So they say that trophozoite of Entamoeba histolytica will have a finger like pseudopodia. They have a finger like pseudopodia, whereas trophozoite of Entamoeba coli, the pseudopodia is blunt pseudopodia. This is one of the major difference. And please remember, trophozoite will not have any shape. They are motile structures. They will frequently change their shape. So any shape you can draw. How to differentiate the cyst? the cyst of entamoeba is round, 8 to 10 micron in size, and mature cyst has 4, 1 to 4 nuclei will be there. Whereas E. coli, it is also round, but larger in size, 20 to 30 microns in size, and nucleus maximum up to 8 will be there. Maximum up to 8 will be there. How can you differentiate individual nucleus of E. coli and E. histolytica? If you take only one nucleus of E. H., one nucleus of E. coli, how can you differentiate? They say that E. H., the nucleus is lined by chromatin dots, the nuclear membrane is lined by fine peripheral chromatin dots, and the karyosome is central. The karyosome is central in nature, central karyosome. I am drawing the inside structure of the nucleus. EH, the nuclear membrane is lined internally by fine peripheral chromatin dot, and it has a central karyosome. Whereas E. coli, the peripheral chromatin dots are coarse. Okay? And the karyosome is not central, it is eccentric. Eccentric karyosome. So, this is how you can differentiate inside of nucleus. The individual nucleus of E. coli and EH can be differentiated based on these properties. Okay. And please remember that the Entamoeba histolytica, cyst and trophozoites, if you get, can you say that it is pathogenic? What I mean to say is Entamoeba histolytica is always pathogenic. If you get trophozoite, no, they say that Entamoeba histolytica has got two subspecies. I mean, now they have, it has got three subspecies, histolytica, histolytica, this alone is pathogen, whereas other two subspecies are histolytica dispar and histolytica moskowski. Dispar and moskowski are non-pathogen. Histolytica has got three subspecies, histolytica, histolytica, histolytica dispar and histolytica moskowski. Among the three, only histolytica subspecies histolytica is a pathogen, whereas dispar and moskowski both are non-pathogen and they may be found as a commensal in your stool. Hence, it is very essential to differentiate these three subspecies. They say that the cyst and trophozoite of all the three subspecies are morphologically similar. You cannot differentiate cyst and trophozoite of histolytica subspecies histolytica from that of dispar and moskowski. Hence, they say that the only way to differentiate these three subspecies is best is by doing a PCR. PCR is done to detect the specific gene of the respective subspecies. Otherwise, you can look for antigen detection in stool, because they say that lectin antigen, which is the virulence factor, it is only present in Entamoeba histolytica subspecies histolytica, will not be there in other subspecies because they are non-pathogen. Other than that, you can also go for specific isoenzyme detection. Entamoeba histolytica produces various isoenzymes, and the isoenzymes of three subspecies are different than each other. So specific isoenzyme detection by a study called as zymodine study can be done to detect the respective isoenzymes. What about if you detect RBC inside trophozoite? See, trophozoite may be same, the morphology of trophozoite may be same, but RBC inside the trophozoite is a sign of invasion. So that is positive only for histolytic subspecies histolytic, fine. And then coming to extra intestinal amoebiasis, the most common site is liver followed by lungs, okay. And liver, the most common site is posterior superior aspect of right liver. This is the most common site, posterior superior aspect of right liver, okay. So the how to diagnose extra intestinal amoebiasis, especially amoebic liver abscess, how to diagnose? Amoebic liver abscess is diagnosed mainly by antibody detection in serum by PCR, by ELISA, and other methods can be used to detect antibodies in serum. Of course, PCR in liver aspirate, this also is a, this is of course the best method, PCR using the specific primers to detect Entamoeba histolytica genes in the liver aspirate. Please remember, if you go for stool microscopy, it is, even if it is a positive, it is non-conclusive. Why because stool microscopy, if it is positive, what is the possibility that even the liver abscess is due to Entamoeba histolytica only? It may be some other cause of liver abscess. So stool microscopy, even if it is positive, it is non-conclusive. What about liver aspirate microscopy? Can you tell me what is the characteristic liver pus is called as Ankovi-Schoss pus? Ankovi-Schoss pus or chocolate syrup? And this particular Ankovi-Schoss pus, if you do a microscopy, they say that you will get trophozoites or cyst or both. Only trophozoites are seen, never cyst, but the sensitivity is very low. Maybe 10 to 20% is the sensitivity. So PCR and antibody detection in serum, these are the better method for diagnosis of amoebic liver abscess. Fine. Let us now discuss free living amoeba. Okay, before that, drug of choice, can you tell? Entamoeba histolytica, they say that for dysentery, Entamoeba histolytica, the drug of choice for dysentery, it is metronidazole, and for luminal infection, even you can give paramomycin, okay. Invasive also metronidazole, whether it is invasive or dysentery, metronidazole for luminal infection. Luminal infection means it will destroy the cyst, because cyst alone will be there, cyst will be there in lumen. Whereas invasive infection, metronidazole is given. So this is all about treatment. Then coming to free living amoeba, there are fourth free living amoeba also. They are named as Naegleria, Acanthamoeba. These two are common, whereas other two are rare. They are Balamuthia and Sapinia. These two are rare free living amoeba. differences between Naegleria and acanthamoeba. Naegleria causes primary amoebic meningoencephalitis. PAM, primary amoebic meningoencephalitis. And the risk factor for this is swimming. Swimming is a very important risk factor. Okay. And they say that acanthamoeba, the risk factors are either HIV infected people or contact lens user. For HIV infected people, it causes GI. GI is granulomatous amoebic encephalitis. For contact lens user, it causes corneal ulcerosis. Okay, so these are the two important manifestations of acanthamoeba. Coming to other differences, Naegleria exists in three morphological forms. It has a trophozoite, has a cyst, and a flagellated form. Trophozoite, cyst, and flagellated form. Among this, the infective form and the diagnostic form in CSF. Infective form and the diagnostic form in CSF, both are trophozoites. Both are trophozoites. Whereas acanthamoeba exists in two morphological form. It has a trophozoite and a cyst. And the infective form and diagnostic form, both they say that both can be infective form, both can be diagnostic form, but of course trophozoite is a better answer than cyst. Trophozoite is more common form in the infective form as well as diagnostic form, but otherwise even cyst also can be seen, and cysts are usually seen in corneal ulcer. Okay, and they say that acanthamoeba, trophozoite and cyst, there are specific features to identify them. The trophozoite of acanthamoeba has a very peculiar pseudopodia, thorn like pseudopodia called as acanthopodia. Thorn like pseudopodia called as acanthopodia, whereas cyst of acanthamoeba is bivalved, double wall. It has inner smooth wall whereas a outer wrinkled wall. The description of cyst is, cyst of acanthamoeba has a outer wrinkled wall. Outer wrinkled wall. Okay. Then again, other differences like here, acanthamoeba, Naegleria, you will have neutrophilic infiltration, or acanthamoeba lymphocytic infiltration will be there. Naegleria is common in temperate countries, whereas acanthamoeba is common in tropical country like India. Naegleria direct neural spread is seen, whereas acanthamoeba hematogenous spread is more common. So, okay, so these are the various other differences between Naegleria and acanthamoeba. Fine. So now we will discuss about flagellates. Flagellates, if it is an intestinal flagellates, example is Giardia. Genital flagellate, example is Trichomonas. And hemoflagellates, example is Leishmania and Trypanosoma. Okay, so these are the various flagellates what we are going to discuss. Apart from that, there is a ciliate. The only ciliated parasite which infect human being is Balanitidium coli. Balanitidium coli. So let us discuss one by one. Giardia. Giardia again has two form. It has a trophozoite and a cyst. Trophozoite is pear shaped or tear drop shape in front view, whereas lateral view, if you see, it is sickle shaped or spoon shaped. In front view, Giardia trophozoite has two nucleus, and which is nearby, it has got two adhesive discs also. These are called as sucking disc or adhesive disc. And this adhesive disc is responsible for adhesion to duodenal mucosa. And that is why, again, I have to tell you that trophozoites are the pathogenic form, because they are responsible for adhesion to GI mucosa. Apart from that, trophozoites, Giardia trophozoites will have flagella. How many flagella? The flagella numbers are 4 pair. 4 pair means how many flagella? 8 flagella. In contrast, cyst is oval. Cyst is oval, having a remnant of flagella called as exostyle. Remnant of flagella called as exostyle and 4 nucleus. The mature cyst has got tetranucleus, 4 nucleus. And like amoeba, like Entamoeba histolytica, Giardia cyst also is the infective form as well as diagnostic form. Cyst is the infective form as well as diagnostic form, but what it suggests, if you detect cyst, it may be a carrier. Once in a while, trophozoites will be seen, very rarely, but they indicate active infection, same like Entamoeba histolytica. So, which is the infective form? Tetranucleated cyst. Pathogenic form, trophozoites. Diagnostic form, usual diagnostic form, cyst indicates carrier. Once in a while, a trophozoite indicates active infection. And what kind of clinical manifestation? Clinical manifestation, the most common form is they produce fatty diarrhea, malabsorption of fat, called as steatorrhea. Malabsorption of fat called as steatorrhea, clinical manifestation. Then about, they say that Giardia is a hepatitis duodenal parasite. The habitat of Giardia is duodenal parasite. So now you tell me, the chance of detection by stool microscopy is less or more compared to Entamoeba histolytica? It is less sensitive because it is a duodenal parasite. If stool microscopy is negative, then you can directly aspirate the sample from the duodenal site by a test called as string test or enterotest. String test or enterotest is done to directly collect the sample from the duodenum by string, asking the patient to swallow a string attached to a gelatin capsule, which will collect the sample, and if you pull the skin, the specimen will come out. String test or enterotest, fine. So now we will discuss about Trichomonas, genital flagellate. Trichomonas trophozoite is the only stage. Trophozoite is the only stage, there is no cyst. Okay, and the trophozoite description is, it is also pear shaped, having one nucleus GID how much? 2 nucleus. Trichomonas 1 nucleus. And it has total 5 flagella. 4 plus 1 flagella, that is 4 anterior and 1 posterior flagella. Posterior flagella looks like an undulating membrane. Undulating membrane. Okay, so this is how the trichomonas trophozoite appear, and trichomoniasis is characterized by, they say that it is characterized by 4 important features. Again, thin profuse vaginal discharge. pH of more than 4.5. They say that it is like bacterial vaginosis. I mean, the manifestations are like bacterial vaginosis. Thin profuse vaginal discharge, pH more than 4.5, offensive smell, and the smell is increased by adding potassium hydroxide called as whip test. And the fourth point in bacterial vaginosis is Klusel, which is pathognomic of bacterial vaginosis. Whereas here, instead of Klusel, if you do a microscopy, what you will get is trophozoites. Apart from that, one more pathognomic feature is strawberry appearance of vaginal mucosa. Strawberry appearance of vaginal mucosa. Strawberry appearance of vaginal mucosa. Then hemoflagellates, blood flagellates, that is nothing but Leishmania and trypanosoma. Both Leishmania and trypanosoma, they exist in 4 morphological form depending upon the arrangement of flagella. They are called as amastigot, promastigot, epimastigot and trypomastigot form. There are 4 mastigoid form, there are 4 morphological form. A mastigoid form is round, having a exostyle in the inside, but there is no flagella outside. So, absence of flagella, that is why it is called as A mastigoid form. Pro mastigoid form, flagella is present anteriorly, anterior flagella. Epimastigoid form, flagella arises laterally, lateral flagella, whereas trypomastigoid form, here they say that flagella arises posteriorly and traverses as an undulating membrane, traverses as an undulating membrane. Okay. In Leishmania, AP forms are seen, AP for A and promastigot, whereas in trypanosoma all forms are seen. However, the infective form and diagnostic form is trypomastigot form. The infective form and diagnostic form is trichomastigoid form. Leishmania AP forms are seen, AP means A mastigoid and promastigoid forms are seen. A mastigoid form is the human form, it is present inside human body as LD bodies. It is present inside human body as LD bodies, and this is the diagnostic form, this is the diagnostic form. Whereas promastigoid forms are insect form, hence they are the infective form. They are the infective form. Fine. So let us discuss Leishmania. Leishmania, which is the infective form? I told. It is transmitted by what? Leishmania is transmitted by sand fly. And sand fly, which form will be there? Promastigoid form. So, when the sand fly bite, the promastigmate form will be discharged onto the skin and they will be taken up by skin macrophages, and the macrophages, so promastigmate form will be taken up by skin macrophages. So, this is a promastigmate form which is taken up by the skin macrophages, and inside the macrophage pro to A transformation will take place. Then macrophage carrying plenty of A mastigmate form are carried away to various organs via the bloodstream, and this is called as LD body. LD body means it is nothing but it is a big macrophage containing plenty of A mastigmate form, which is carried out to various organs. Various organ like spleen, bone marrow, lymph node, etcetera. Okay, overall life cycle of leishmania. So leishmaniasis is of two types: old world leishmaniasis and new world. Old world leishmaniasis is due to three important members: Leishmania donovani, old world, new world. Why they are called like this? Old world means Asia and Africa, new world means America. So Leishmania donovani, Leishmania chagas, Leishmania tropica and Leishmania Ethiopia, these are the member of old world. Whereas new world is Leishmania brasiliensis, mexicana and chagasi, these are new world Leishmania species. Donovani causes VL. What is VL? Visceral leishmaniasis, also called as Kalajar. It also causes PKDL. Tropica causes cutaneous leishmaniasis, which is called as oriental sore or Delhi boil. It is endemic in Gujarat, Rajasthan. It is endemic in Rajasthan. Ethiopia causes diffuse cutaneous leishmaniasis. Diffuse cutaneous leishmaniasis. Brasiliensis causes mucocutaneous leishmaniasis, which is called as Espundia. Mucocutaneous leishmaniasis. Mexicana causes a ear lesion called as Chicrel ulcer. Espundia usually affect the nasal septum, whereas Mexicana causes a ear lesion, a lesion in the ear called, described as Chicler ulcer. Chagasi can cause cutaneous leishmaniasis as well as visceral leishmaniasis. Of course, it is the only species in new world which can cause visceral leishmaniasis. Then vector. Regarding vector, old world leishmaniasis, the vector is phlebotomous. Both the vectors, sand fly only, but sand fly of the genus phlebotomous for old world. New world, sand fly of the genus Ludzomia. Ludzomia. For donovani, it is phlebotomous argentipis. The species is argentipis. Tropica, it is phlebotomous sergenti. And Ethiopia, it is phlebotomous longipes. Argentipis, sergenti and longipes are the respective vector for Donovani tropica and Ethiopia. So this is again a very important table what they can ask in the exam, so you have to remember. Let us discuss a bit about visceral leishmaniasis or kalaja. As I told you, the manifestation of visceral leishmaniasis is depending upon the organ affected. Where the LD bodies are deposited, I told. LD bodies are carried out through blood and they are deposited in various organs. Which organs? Spleen. So, you will have a splenomegaly, eosplenomegaly. Bone marrow deposition lead to bone marrow suppression. That causes pancytopenia, and as a reflex you will have polyclonal B cell activation, so hyper gamma globulinemia, pancytopenia, and to compensate that hyper gamma globulinemia, non specific antibodies will be produced. Lymph node also will be affected mainly in African patients, and in Indian patient what it is called is in India kalajar. Kalajar means kala is black, that is you will have hyperpigmentation, and jara is fever. So hyperpigmentation and fever are the two important feature of Indian form of visceral leishmaniasis. And in VL, after the recovery of VL, maybe 2 to 20 years later, there is another manifestation of leishmaniasis which is called as PKDL, stands for post kalajar dermal leishmaniasis. Post kalajar dermal leishmaniasis. And they say that this post kalajar dermal leishmaniasis is seen in 2 to 10 years after the effective treatment of VL, and is usually seen in India as well as in African country named as Sudan. India and Sudan, both the places it is there, and the lesions are usually non-ulcerative, hypopigmented, nodular lesion. So, this is a description of PKDL lesions. We should not be confused with that of hyperpigmentation of kalajar. Kalajar will have hyperpigmentation. Here, hypopigmented, non-ulcerative, nodular lesion. Nodular lesion. Okay. And what happens in HIV individual? VL in HIV people. In HIV individual, they say that the routine hepatosplenomegaly will be absent. Instead of that, you will have more respiratory and more GI symptom, like you will have dysphagia, dyspnea, etc. The routine hepatosplenomegaly will be absent. Instead of that, more respiratory and GI manifestations may be seen. Fine. So, lab diagnosis of kalajar. Kalajar, the lab diagnosis, first is specimen collection. Which is the specimen of choice? The most sensitive specimen is splenic aspirate. Splenic aspirate, but usually we splenic aspirate we do not do because of the risk of splenic hemorrhage. So, the most common specimen will be bone marrow aspirate. Specimen in African patient, lymph node aspirate. Specimen in HIV infected people, they say that the buffy coat, area you have to, that is peripheral blood only is the specimen of choice. But peripheral blood you do centrifuge, and the buffy coat area is examined in HIV infected people. Peripheral blood is taken, centrifuged, and the buffy coat area is examined for HIV infected patient. And when you examine, what you will get, all this, when all this specimen, when you do a microscopy, you what form will be seen? LD bodies. LD bodies are what? A mastigote or pro mastigote? Macrophage containing A mastigote. But all these specimen, when you subject to culture, culture medium is triple N medium, and Sneeders Drosophila medium. Sneeders Drosophila medium. So in this medium, in the culture medium, they say that A mastigote to pro mastigote transformation takes place. So the pro mastigote forms are seen in culture, whereas A mastigote form in the form of LD bodies are seen in where? Smear microscopy A mastigote form and culture pro mastigote form. Apart from that, antibody detection, antibodies may be non-specific hyper gamma globulinemia, what is there, that can be detected by various antibody detection methods like Napier's aldehyde test and Chopra's antimony test. These tests detect the non-specific hyper gamma globulinemia. So these are outdated tests, we don't do. What we do is specific anti-leishmanial antibody detection. This is done by ELISA, immunofluorescent assay, direct agglutination test, okay, complement fixation test, complement fixation test also they say it is not very specific, so you can remove. What you can do is, you can, the last but the most important is immunochromatographic test, detecting antibody against RK39 antigen. Immunochromatographic test detecting antibody against RK39 antigen. So this is upcoming, this is quite popular nowadays. Apart from that, skin test can be done, that is Montenegro test, Montenegro or Leishmanianin test, Leishmanianin test, Leishmanianin test or Montenegro test. They say that Montenegro test is a positive only if the CMI is intact. So patient with active VL and DCL, there the Montenegro test will be negative. They say that it is positive only when the CMI is intact, and the CMI is intact in mainly in the CL or recovered VL, whereas Montenegro test will be negative in active VL and also diffuse CL. Diffuse CL also it will be negative. So it is hypersensitivity type 4. A Montenegro test is an example of hypersensitivity type 4. Molecular tests like PCR can be done to detect the kinetoplast DNA. Treatment, and okay, of course, animal model will be golden hamsters. Golden hamsters are the animal model for leishmaniasis. Treatment of choice, they say that pentavalent and antimonials are the drug of choice. And this is given in most of the places except Bihar. Bihar amphotericin B is given because Bihar the resistance to antimonial compounds have been reported, hence amphotericin B is the drug of choice in Bihar. Other anti-leishmanial drugs includes paramomycin, miltefosin. Okay, these are the other antimonial drugs. So this is all about leishmaniasis. Then we can discuss trypanosoma. Trypanosoma, what I told you, which is an infective form, diagnostic form, T for T, that is trypomastigoid forms are infective form as well as diagnostic form. And trypanosoma has got two brothers. Trypanosoma cruzi, Trypanosoma brucei. They say that both these two brothers have never seen each other because they reside in respective area. Trypanosoma cruzi is the agent of American trypanosomiasis. American trypanosomiasis is called as Chagas disease, whereas brucei is seen in Africa. Cruzi is transmitted by the vector of Trypanosoma cruzi is Radovig bug. Whereas the vector of Trypanosoma brucei is shishi fly. And coming to Trypanosoma cruzi or Chagas disease, usually it occurs in two forms, acute Chagas disease and chronic Chagas disease. Acute Chagas disease at the site of deposition of Radovig bug, at the site of inoculation of Radovig bug, you will have a subcutaneous swelling called as chagoma. Apart from that, a periorbital edema also may be seen. Periorbital edema will be seen, which is called as Romanus sign. Whereas chronic Chagas disease, you have to easy to remember is lot of M, like myocarditis, mega colon, mega esophagus, meningoencephalitis, muscle pain. All these are the various manifestation of chronic Chagas disease, and usually it is autoimmune. The manifestation of chronic Chagas disease is due to autoimmune mechanism. Molecular mimicry is the reason behind the various manifestation of chronic Chagas disease. Okay. Then coming to Trypanosoma brucei. Trypanosoma brucei, as I told you, it is agent of African trypanosomiasis. African trypanosomiasis is called as sleeping sickness. And it is transmitted by vector shishi fly. Again, brucei has got two sons who have never seen each other. They are brucei gambiens and brucei rhodesiens. They are the respective agent of Western African and Eastern African sleeping sickness. Both the vector is shishi fly. The Gambians, they say that it is a human parasite and it produces a chronic milder form of CNS disease as well as lymph node involvement is quite common, and one of the important sign is cervical lymphadenopathy, which is called as winter bottom sign. W for W, winter bottom sign, Western African. Okay. However, this is a less virulent parasite. That is why it is, I told you, milder infection it will produce, and also drug resistant also is less. Less drug resistant have been reported. In contrast, African sleeping sickness, that is rhodesiens, is agent of Eastern African sleeping sickness, and it is zoonotic. That is, rodents, cattle and other animals are involved in their maintenance of the parasite reservoir. So, humans are unusual host. Because humans are not the normal host, unusual host, when they infect, they will produce a exaggerated or severe form of CNS disease, which is described as acute severe CNS disease. It is so acute and severe that death occurs less than 9 months. Before 9 months, the death occurs. However, lymph node involvement is rare, and this parasite is more virulent as well as more drug resistance has been reported. They ask the treatment of choice. Drug of choice is pentamidin and suramin respectively. Pentamidin and suramin are the respective drug of choice here. Next chapter is the most important chapter in entire parasitology, Plasmodium. How many species are there? 4 species for a student who is writing a 10th exam, but you are writing entrance, PG entrance. So, there are 5 species, and Plasmodium vivax, falciparum, malariae, oval, and the last is Plasmodium knowlesi, and all these are. Of course, Knowlesi is not found in India yet, but it is endemic in other places. So, you have to remember something about Knowlesi also. So, without wasting much time, let us now directly go to the life cycle. Malaria life cycle is again very important for exam. Definitive host, intermediate host. Which is man? Intermediate host is man. Definitive host, which mosquito? Female Anopheles mosquito. And they say that if the mode of transmission is mosquito bite, then the infective form is sporozoite, but mode of transmission can also blood transfusion and vertical transmission from mother to fetus. In these 2 cases, the infective form will be merozoites. Directly merozoites can be the infective form. Okay. And in such case, if in blood transfusion, what are the differences? Merozoites, so transfusion associated malaria, how it is different than the mosquito borne malaria? If it is transfusion associated malaria, then of course, as I told you, merozoites are the infective form, and directly the merozoites will be entering into the blood. So, there is no liver cycle. If there is no liver cycle, there is no hypnozoites. Hypnozoites are the dormant stage in liver. If there is no hypnozoite, then there is no relapse. If there is no relapse, there is no need to give the drug of choice of relapse, that is primaquine. All these are the differences between a transfusion associated malaria and a mosquito borne malaria. Okay, so with this now let us start. What happens in a normal case when the female Anopheles mosquito bites? What happens when the female Anopheles mosquito bites? They say that the sporozoids are the infective form, they are released to the skin. From the skin they will enter to the blood, and in 30 minutes from blood they enter into the liver. In liver, 90% of the sporozoids they transform into trophozoid. The liver cycle is called as hepatic cycle or pre-erythrocytic or exo-erythrocytic cycle. Both all are same, pre-erythrocytic, exo-erythrocytic, hepatic cycle. And in liver, the 90% of the sporozoids they form trophozoids. Trophozoids are the feeding stage of the parasite. They will multiply. They multiply and they will grow in number. After some time they divide, and they divide by pre-erythrocytic zygogony. They undergo pre-erythrocytic zygogony to produce a pre-erythrocytic zygote. Pre-erythrocytic zygote. Pre-erythrocytic zygote undergo zygogony to release the pre-erythrocytic merozoids. To release the pre-erythrocytic merozoids. Pre-erythrocytic merozoids are the infective form to RBC. They infect RBC. So, this happens to how many cases? How much of sporozoids? 90%. The remaining 10% of sporozoids, they are as lazy as you, they will become hypnozoid inside the liver. Hypnozoids are the dormant stage of the parasite, which do not cause any infection, but 2 to 3 years later they will produce relapse of malaria. And can you tell me how relapse is different than recrudescence? Please remember, this hypnozoid is a stage is seen only in V for vivax and oval. Only vivax and oval 10% will become hypnozoid. Falciparum all will become trophozoid. There is no hypnozoid in falciparum. In contrast, recrudescence is a phenomenon which is seen in falciparum and malaria. Falciparum and malaria, these two you have, you can get recrudescence. And recrudescence is due to drug resistance. Relapse is due to hypnozoids. Recrudescence is due to drug resistance. They say that recrudescence occurs 2 to 3 weeks of treatment. Relapse occurs 2 to 3 years of primary attack. And 2 to 3 weeks after treatment, the drug resistance Plasmodium falciparum, if they are resistant Plasmodium falciparum, 2 to 3 weeks of treatment later, they can cause a second episode of malaria, and this is called as recrudescence of malaria. This is seen in which species? Falciparum and malaria, whereas relapse is seen in V for vivax and oval. So now come back to the life cycle, because we have discussed only half. Let us discuss the other part of the life cycle, RBC cycle. So, which is the infective form for RBC? Pre-erythrocytic merozoids. So, inside RBC, they say that the pre-erythrocytic merozoids inside RBC, they will grow to form trophozoids. Trophozoids, first they will form early trophozoids, that is ring form. Early trophozoids are nothing but they are the ring form. Early trophozoite later on will become late trophozoite. Late trophozoite will multiply to form zygote. Zygote undergoes zygogony. Zygogony releases the erythrocytic merozoites. Erythrocytic merozoites, once they are released, how they are released? By the bursting of the RBC. They say that RBC, the zygote, when they are released, they will burst the RBC. RBC will be lysed, so that erythrocytic merozoites will be released out. So when they are released out, along with that, the hemoglobin digested byproducts also will be released, which are called as hemojoin. You know that inside RBC hemoglobin will be there, and hemoglobin is the nutrition for the parasite. Malaria parasite feed on hemoglobin and degrade hemoglobin to produce certain byproducts called as hemojoin pigment. And along with the merozoites, the hemojoin byproducts are released, and they are the lethal byproduct which is responsible for various clinical manifestations like fever, chill, rigor. All these clinical manifestations are due to the release of hemojoin pigments. And please remember, after the merozoites are released, these merozoites will again attack the RBC to repeat the cycle. Once the merozoites is released out, RBC cycle is over. So they will again attack fresh RBC. They will again attack fresh RBC to repeat the cycle. Or if they are, or they will become bore of the person, they will transform into gametocyte. Gametocyte is the infective form to mosquito. Gametocyte is the infective form to female Anopheles mosquito. So please remember, in this context, the RBC cycle duration is very important for the manifestation to take place. Yes or no? At the end of the RBC cycle, the hemojoin pigments are released, hence the manifestations they appear. So the duration of RBC cycle is important for the periodicity of the manifestation. For example, Plasmodium vivax and Plasmodium falciparum and Plasmodium oval, all these three, the periodicity is 48 hours. The RBC cycle lasts for 48 hours. That is why they produce tertian malaria. That is, fever occur every third day. Every third day the fever appears. For Plasmodium malariae, the fever occurs every 72 hours. That is every fourth day, which is called as quartan malaria. Plasmodium knowlesi, the periodicity is 24 hours. Hence, fever occurs every day, every alternate day, which is called as quotidian malaria. Quotidian malaria. Okay, so this is how the manifestations occur. So whatever I have discussed, this is about the life cycle of malaria parasite. And they say that the clinical manifestation, the benign manifestation, which is common to all species, that will be fever with chill and rigor, anemia due to burst of RBC, and splenomegaly, because spleen is the site where they will try to engulf the parasitized RBCs and they will try to destroy them. As a result, the spleen will enlarge in size. So this is seen in all species. because these are the features of benign malaria. There is another form of malaria called as malignant malaria, which is seen only in falciparum. And this malignant malaria, of course, the pathogenesis I will tell you first. Why malignant malaria is seen only in falciparum species, not in other species? The reason is falciparum undergoes, in falciparum various specific pathogenesis events take place, which are not there in other species. One of the important event is sequestration of the parasite. Sequestration of Plasmodium falciparum by cytoadherence and rosetting. Cytoadherence and rosetting. This means what? They say, see, this is the RBC and this is the malaria parasite inside, Plasmodium falciparum inside. They say that Plasmodium falciparum releases a protein, expresses out a protein, secretes a protein which is called as PFEMP protein. EMP is erythrocyte membrane protein. So, these proteins it will release out. So, these proteins they will come out and they will be coated on the surface of RBC. They will be coated on the surface of RBC, and these erythrocyte membrane proteins are sticky in nature. Because they are sticky in nature, this results in adhesion. Adhesion to what? One side they will be adherent to vascular endothelium. Other side they may be adherent to normal RBCs also. So, that leads to rosetting. Cytoadherence means adhesion to the vascular endothelium. Rosetting is the clumping of normal RBCs to parasitized RBC. This leads to sequestration of the parasite to the vascular endothelium. So, what you can see here, this property lead to what? See, this is the blood vessels, this is the total blood vessel, in that a part of the blood vessel is occluded. So, sequestration of Plasmodium falciparum, especially in small capillaries of deep vessels, this leads to vascular occlusion. And this is the main mechanism why all these malignant manifestations they take place. Malignant manifestations, the various complications seen under malignant tertian malaria are cerebral malaria. Why cerebral malaria takes place? Because of the brain capillaries will be occluded, leads to cerebral anoxia. Okay. Other than that, black water fever. Okay. Algid malaria. Algid malaria is a shock like stage. Okay. So, all these are the various complications seen in malignant malaria. Then complications seen in other species. Other species complications like nephrotic syndrome. Nephrotic syndrome is a complication specifically seen in Plasmodium malariae. Nephrotic syndrome. Tropical splenomegaly syndrome. Tropical splenomegaly syndrome, it is seen in mainly vivax or maybe in other species also. Tropical splenomegaly syndrome is characterized by splenomegaly and pancytopenia and hyper IgM, three components will be there, splenomegaly, pancytopenia and hyper IgM. Okay, so, all these are various manifestations, fine. So, now let us discuss about a bit of epidemiological features. where malaria is endemic, which is the place where maximum number of malaria cases are found? Is it India or it is outside? India accounts for only 10% of total malaria burden. The main malaria burden reside in sub-Saharan Africa, which accounts for 85% of total malaria cases. India and other SEER countries, Southeast Asian region countries, both together they account only for 10% of total cases. And of course, in the world, Plasmodium vivax is the most common species. Whereas, especially India is concerned, they say that the most common species Plasmodium falciparum and vivax is almost same. You can say that 50% and 49%, almost same, followed by Plasmodium malariae. Malaria is mainly in the Tumkur and Hassan district of Karnataka. And the rarest is Plasmodium oval. And Plasmodium oval, they say that it is very few reports are there in India. Those places are Gujarat, Odisha, Delhi, Assam, okay. So, these are the few places where Plasmodium oval have been reported, okay. So, Gujarat and also Kolkata you can write. Gujarat, Odisha, Delhi, Assam and Kolkata, these are the few places where Plasmodium oval have been reported. Very, very rare, but there are some cases. You can't say that it is not there. Can you tell me which is the most endemic state in India? They say that Odisha accounts for the most endemic, I mean the overall the endemic zone is Eastern India. Eastern India is the most endemic zone. Among that, Odisha accounts for 24% of total malaria burden of India. And in Odisha, 92% of cases are due to Plasmodium falciparum, that is where it is more dangerous. Maximum cases are Plasmodium falciparum. Okay. Then there are certain immunological phenomena. Immunological risk factor. As I told you that Plasmodium falciparum feeds on hemoglobin to produce digested byproduct. So, hemoglobin is the nutrition for malaria parasite, and adult hemoglobin is the most susceptible hemoglobin to Plasmodium. Plasmodium usually feed on adult hemoglobin. However, there are certain conditions, like you, if you have a defective hemoglobin, like thalassemia, sickle cell disease, fetal hemoglobin, all these cases, they are resistant to Plasmodium falciparum. And even spirochetosis. Spirochetosis, the RBC will be fixed, it is not flexible. So, this is a condition where also it will be resistant to malaria parasite. The infection cannot set in, the malaria parasite cannot infect inside. Similarly, G6PD enzyme, G6PD enzymes are essential for Plasmodium to survive. So, if you are G6PD deficient, again those patients will be resistant to falciparum. Similarly, for vivax, the Duffy blood group antigens are important. The Duffy blood group antigens present on RBC membrane. Over the RBC membrane, Duffy blood group antigens are there. Those antigens are receptor for Vivax. Receptor for Vivax. So, if an individual is Duffy negative, if this Duffy blood group antigens are absent, then those individuals will be resistant to Plasmodium virus infection. So, these are the various associated conditions where the risk of Plasmodium is enhanced. So, with this, let us now start the most important part that of Plasmodium, that is laboratory diagnosis. After so many years of diagnosis also, after so many years of discovery also, still then they say that smear microscopy is the gold standard method, peripheral smear microscopy. Peripheral smear microscopy is still the gold standard method. There are two smears are available, thick smear and thin smear. Which is better? Which is more sensitive? Where amount of blood is more? Thick smear, the amount of blood is more, hence it is more sensitive. It is also used for quantification. For quantification, thick smear is the best method. It is also used to demonstrate malaria pigment. It is also used to demonstrate malaria pigments. Whereas, the only advantage of thin smear is it is used for speciation. For speciation, intact RBCs are required, and thick smear, the RBCs are lysed. When you make the thick smear examination, while you prepare the thick smear examination, the RBCs will be destroyed. Hence, the intact RBCs will not be there. For speciation, you need intact RBC so that you can know which species is there inside. So, now I will tell you how the speciation is done, how the thin smear is used for speciation. See, speciation is done based on five important properties: the type of ring form, the type of gametocyte, the type of zygote, the malaria pigment and the RBC structure. Depending upon all these five properties, the speciation is done. Okay. So, let us discuss one by one, or let us discuss in a reverse order. First, I will tell you about RBC. RBC, they say that for Plasmodium vivax, RBC is enlarged. For oval, RBC is enlarged, oval and irregular margin. Enlarged, oval in shape and having a irregular margin. Whereas, the remaining two, that is what? Plasmodium falciparum and malaria, RBC is normal. Coming to malaria pigment. Malaria pigment, they say that for all species, the malaria pigment is dark brown in color. Whereas, except Plasmodium vivax, where it is yellowish brown in color. By detecting which color of malaria pigment, you can speciate. Zygote. Zygote means what? Zygote is a big sac like structure having merozoites inside. How many merozoites they have? This is a property by which you can speciate. How many merozoites are there inside? For vivax and falciparum, 12 to 24 merozoites per zygote. Whereas, malaria and oval, there are 8 merozoites per zygote. 8 merozoites per zygote. And one more thing I want to emphasize here, falciparum in the peripheral blood smear examination, only ring form and gametocytes are seen. Okay, the other forms are seen only in the deep vessels, not in the peripheral blood vessel. So this is again a point to be noted, because falciparum usually multiply the RBC cycle, the most of the part of the RBC cycle occurs in the deep organ vessels, brain vessels, liver vessels and all that. Peripheral blood vessel, only the first form and the last form will be seen. First is ring form and last form is a gametocyte. The remaining stage occurs in the deep vessels. That means if I ask you if you have 12 cyzon in a peripheral blood smear examination, it could be what? Which species it is? Falciparum or vivax? 12 to 24 is either falciparum or vivax. But in peripheral blood smear only vivax is seen. Falciparum is not seen. Next is gametocyte. Gametocyte, they say that falciparum, the gametocyte is banana shaped. Banana shaped gametocyte. Banana shaped or crescentic gametocyte. Whereas other non-PF, it is round gametocyte. Gametocyte is round. Then the most important part, that is ring form. Very very frequently asked MCQ. Ring form based on which, how can you differentiate? Ring form of vivax. Vivax, what is the shape of RBC? RBC in vivax is enlarged. Enlarged RBC. Having a enlarged ring form. They say that the ring form occupies 1/3 of space of RBC. This is the ring form or early trophozoite of vivax. Whereas the late trophozoite of vivax, of course RBC is enlarged and the ring form, the cytoplasm will become irregular, called as amoeboid ring. The cytoplasm becomes irregular, called as amoeboid ring form. So this is about vivax identifying feature. Falciparum, the RBC is normal shape RBC, having three variety of ring form. One is it has multiple ring form. Other one is ring form attached to RBC membrane, called as E. coli form. E. coli form is ring form attached to RBC membrane. Then one more variety is sometime double dot ring form will be there. The nucleus is broken into two pieces, which is called as double dot or headphone shaped ring form, like this. Double dot or headphone shaped ring form will be there. Okay. Coming to Plasmodium malariae. Plasmodium malariae RBC is normal. Normal small, I mean not enlarged, normal round RBC. And the ring form is not actually ring, it is actually band shaped. Band forms, they are called as band forms, or band shaped forms are seen in the, instead of ring it will become a band shaped. Oval, what is the shape of RBC? Oval, the RBC is irregular, oval and enlarged, it is oval in shape and irregular margin, fibrinated, having a ring form inside. So based on the RBC you can tell that it is oval. The ring form doesn't have any specific feature, but based on RBC shape you can tell it is oval. So this is all about peripheral blood microscopy. So other than that, other diagnostic tool for malaria, you can go for a fluorescent microscopy called as Kawamoto technique. A fluorescent plus centrifuge, which is called as QBC. QBC is quantitative Buffy code examination. Quantitative Buffy code examination. Here they say that the blood is collected in a capillary tube. Blood is collected in a capillary tube, and this tube is coated internally with acridinoris. Coated internally with acridine orange. This is a stain which is used here. So once the blood is collected inside, the blood is subjected to centrifuge. So when you centrifuge the blood in the capillary tube, the blood cells will be separated depending upon their molecular weight, depending upon the density, the blood cells will be separated. First, the bottom zone will be the heaviest cell, that is RBC. Then you will have the lighter cells, that is WBC zone. Later on, the platelet zone will be there. So, like that, the blood cells will be separated. Then you have to examine the Buffy coat area. Buffy coat area is examined. Buffy coat area means what? Buffy coat area is the junction of WBC and RBC. Is the WBC junction with RBC, the junction of WBC and RBC, this is the Buffy coat area. This is the area where the parasitized RBCs will be there, and this is the area which is examined under fluorescent microscope. So this is also fluorescent stain, but along with that centrifugation is done in a capillary tube. That is called as QBC, quantitative Buffy coat examination, and they say that it is almost equal sensitivity like thick smear examination. Of course, thick smear is best, followed by QBC, quantitative Buffy coat examination. Then antigen detection. Third is antigen detection by doing immunochromatographic test. Here they say that you can detect various antigens like parasitic LDH, histidine rich protein 2 and aldolase. Among the three antigen, the LDH and aldolase antigens are pan malarial antigen. They are present in all the species, whereas histidine rich protein 2 is PF specific. It is PF specific antigen. It is present only in Plasmodium falciparum. So if histidine rich protein 2 will be positive, that means it can confirm that it is Plasmodium falciparum. Okay, then culture, it is not done routinely, it is done only in the research center. RPMI 1640 medium is used, and by following a method called as Trager and Jensen method. Trager and Jensen method is used using RPMI 1640 medium. It is not routinely done, it is done only in reference centers. Fine. So this is all about the, and of course PCR, the last diagnostic tool is PCR using the various primers, and PCR is most sensitive. It can speciate all the four species as well as it can detect the drug resistance gene. It can detect the drug resistant gene, hence PCR is quite, but the thing is because it is sophisticated, it is very difficult to perform, so it is again limited only to the higher centers. Okay, then a bit about Plasmodium nullesi. Plasmodium nullesi is the latest species discovered. It is a parasite of monkey. It usually infects monkeys. Not reported in India yet. Over the world, they say that around 2010 onwards, cases have been reported mainly from Thailand, also from other countries like Singapore and all, mainly from Thailand and also from other Asian countries like Singapore, etcetera. Here the vector is, they say that here how it is different than diagnostic feature. They say that Plasmodium nullesi, the early trophozoites resembles that of Plasmodium falciparum, whereas the late trophozoites resembles to that of Plasmodium malariae, band form like it will be there, which will resemble to Plasmodium malariae, whereas early trophozoites they resemble to Plasmodium falciparum, multiple ring form, other forms will be seen. Okay, and as I told you here, the vector is a particular species of Anopheles called as Anopheles leucospirus. And they say that though Plasmodium nullesi is not found in India, but Anopheles leucospirus is found in the western coastal region, belt of India. So, there is a high probability that we may get Plasmodium nullesi in near future. Okay, and of course, fever, I have told you, fever pattern is quotidian pattern. Every 24 hours. Okay, so this is all about. Then a bit about Babesia. Babesia is also a parasite that infects RBC. Babesia is also a parasite that infects intra erythrocytic parasite, but how it differs from malaria is, first of all, it is zoonotic. Various animals will be affected, like cattle, etcetera. Here the vector is tick. Here ticks are the vector, and they say that regarding the diagnosis, ring forms are arranged in tetrad. Inside the RBC, tetrad of ring form will be present. This is called as Maltese cross form. And of course, the drug of choice here is tetracycline. In contrast to Plasmodium, it is resistant to chloroquine. Plasmodium chloroquine is the drug of choice. Here it is resistant to chloroquine, and tetracycline is usually given for treatment. Clindamycin also is given for treatment. Okay, and the other difference is, they say that it is more important in splenectomized and immunocompromised individual. This is the risk factor. Splenectomite and immunocompromised individual, especially Babesia bovis, is a species which is usually affects the splenectomized and immunocompromised individuals. Okay, and another point to be remembered, there is no cerebral malaria feature. There is no cerebral malaria manifestation. In contrast to malaria, here there is no cerebral manifestations are there. Okay, so these are the differences between Babesia and malaria. This finishes this chapter. Sites. There are four important members under this, and all these members, they are known to produce opportunistic infection in HIV individual. Among this, three members, they cause opportunistic diarrhea, whereas one causes opportunistic encephalitis. Encephalitis infection, opportunistic encephalitis by Toxoplasma, whereas diarrhea by Cryptosporidium, Isospora and Cyclospora. So, these are the general, I mean important members of coccidian parasite. Coming to Toxoplasma. Toxoplasma, they say that the definitive host are cat and other feline animals. The intermediate host, of course, is man. It exists in three morphological form. It has tachyzoids, which are usually found in blood. It has tissue cyst. It exists as a tissue cyst containing many small bradyzoids. Tissue cyst is composed of bradyzoids inside, and this is usually seen in tissues, organs and muscles. Third is oocyst. Oocyst is seen in cat species. So, three morphological forms are there. And if they ask you which is the infective form, answer is it is the only parasite where all the morphological forms are infective. But if they ask you which is the commonest, most common infective form, then the most common infective form is related to most common mode of transmission. The most common mode of transmission is contaminated food and water. Contaminated food and water with cat's feces. That means, which is the infective form? Oocyst. Second is ingestion of viscera containing tissue cyst. Okay. Of course, cat we do not eat, but there are so many other feline animal which they can be eaten. So, viscera containing tissue cyst. Next is blood transfusion or vertical transmission, where tachyzoids are the infective form. Okay, clear? Regarding the clinical manifestation, congenital. Toxoplasma is one of the torch agents. What is torch? T for toxo, rubella, cytomegalovirus, H for herpes, O for others like HIV discussed, varicella zoster virus, parvovirus and congenital syphilis. All these will come under other category. So coming to congenital toxoplasmosis, they say that a transmission is maximum during delivery, whereas severity is maximum in first trimester. Okay. And during delivery or third trimester, you can remember, third trimester the transmission is relatively maximum. The most common form of congenital, most common symptom, most common manifestation of congenital toxoplasmosis is chorioretinitis. Chorioretinitis. And as I told you earlier, if the mother is having primary infection, then the risk is more or less, more maximum risk if the mother is having primary infection. Congenital toxoplasmosis is identified by, diagnosis is by having detection of IgM antibody or IgA antibody in fetus. They say that IgA antibody is more sensitive indicator than IgM, more sensitive indicator than IgM. Other than that, of course, toxoplasma antigen can be detected, or you can go for a PCR detecting gene in amniotic fluid. PCR detecting gene in amniotic fluid. Okay. So, this is about congenital toxoplasmosis. Then adult. Adult, most of them are asymptomatic, and among the symptoms, the most common manifestation is cervical lymphadenopathy. Cervical lymphadenopathy. HIV infected individual, they say that the association is around 15 to 40% association. 15 to 40% of HIV individuals are co-infected with toxoplasma. Most common manifestation in HIV individual is encephalitis, affecting most common site is brainstem. And the CD4 count falls below 100, this is the most important risk factor. Okay. So, this is about toxoplasmosis in HIV individuals. Lab diagnosis, they say that if you do a peripheral blood microscopy, then you may get tachyoides. If you do tissue section microscopy, then you will get tissue cyst containing, which is more important, which indicates active infection, which indicates dormant. Tachy and brady, what is the difference? Tachy is active, brady is dormant. So, tachyoid presence is more important than tissue cyst. Okay. So, this is about microscopy. Then antibody detection, they say that Sabin Feldman test is a gold standard method, method of diagnosis, Sabin Feldman test. Other than that, you have various antibody detection tests like ELISA, immunofluorescein assay, etcetera. Okay. Then of course, PCR can be done to detect the specific genes. ट्रीटमेंट कोट टैमोक्सिजन, दे से दैट इन इम्यूनो कॉम्पिटेंट नो ट्रीटमेंट इज रिक्वायर्ड. प्रेग्नेंसी स्पाइडामाइसिन इज द ड्रग ऑफ चॉइस. HIV infected individual, cotrimoxazole is given. Is given for prophylaxis. It is started when the CD4 count falls below 100. Discontinued if the CD4 count rises more than 200. And secondary prophylaxis, again you have to start if the CD4 count falls below 200. This is the guideline you have to follow. CD4 count, the primary prophylaxis starts below 100, discontinued above 200. When it falls below 200 again, secondary prophylaxis start. This is about toxoplasma. Then let us discuss the other three diarrheogenic, the diarrhea producing opportunistic infection. What are they? Cryptosporidium, Cyclospora, Isospora. They say that the sporulated oocyst, sporulated means mature oocyst is the infective form for all the sporulated oocyst is the infective form. Okay, and the description of sporulated oocyst is Cryptosporidium. It is round, 4 to 6 micron in size, containing 4 sporozoids. Cyclospora is again round, 8 to 10 micron, contain 2 sporocysts, and each sporocyst contains 2 sporozoids, 2 in number in each. Isospora is oval, it is 20 to 30 micron, contains again 2 sporocysts. Each sporocyst contains 4 sporozoids. This description is very important, very frequently they ask. And among this, all the cysts are acid fast, all the oocysts are acid fast. However, Cyclospora is variably acid fast, and Cyclospora oocyst is having a property of autofluorescence also. It has a property of autofluorescence also. Fine. Then where the sporulation takes place. They say that for Cryptosporidium, sporulation takes place inside GIT also, inside the GIT. That is why the diagnostic form is sporulated oocyst, whereas for other two the sporulation takes place in soil environment. So, the diagnostic form is unsporulated oocyst. That is what is released in feces, that will become sporulated where? In the environment. And which is the infective form? Sporulated oocyst. Drug of choice, nitazoxanide is the drug of choice for Cryptosporidium, whereas other two cotrimoxazole is given. other two co-trimoxazole is given. Fine. So this is all about. Then we can discuss a bit about cystode. Cystode and trematode. Cystodes, also they are called as tapeworm. They are flat. They are flatworms. And the classification of cystode is based on habitat. You can classify as intestinal cystode and somatic cystode. Intestinal cystode example is tinea, tinea saginata, as well as tinea solium. Both can cause intestinal manifestation. H. nana, diphyllobothrium latum, all these can cause intestinal manifestation. Somatic or tissue cystode, echinococcus. And don't forget, tinea solium, though it can cause intestinal manifestation, it can also cause what? Cysticercosis. Hence, it is also a somatic cystode. Coming to the various morphological form, they say that they exist in three form. They exist in larva. Larva will become adult. Adult will undergo fertilization to produce egg. Three forms they exist. The larva of different cystode, they have given different name. For example, tinea, the larva is called as Cysticercus. Cysticercus is the larval name of tinea. Tinea saginata, it is Bovis, whereas tinea solium, it is Cysticercus cellulose. Hymenolepis nana, the larval form is called as Cysticercoid. Cysticercoid. D. latum, it has got three larval form, L1, L2 and L3. Among this, L3, which is the pleurocercoid form, this is the infective form. This is the infective form. Somatic cystode, echinococcus, hydatid disease, I mean hydatid cyst is the larval form of echinococcus. So these are the various larval form given to various cystodes. Coming to egg, most of the cystodes, they have a egg shell and they have three pair of hooklets. Three pairs of hooklets. Okay. Except D. latum. D. latum, the egg is operculated. Operculated means what? There is a lid. It has a lid. Operculated egg. Fine. So with this introduction, now let us attack one by one. Tineasis. Tineasis is of two type. Intestinal tineasis. Other one is cysticercosis. Agent. Intestinal tineasis, tinea solium and Sajanata. Cystic sarcosis is only tinea. Solium. Host. Man is a definitive host. Whereas intermediate host. Pigs for Solium. Cattle for Sajanata. Whereas for cystic sarcosis, man act as definitive host as well as intermediate host. Please remember, pigs do not play a role in the life cycle of cystic sarcosis. Transmission and infective form for intestinal tinnitus is larva. Larva means what? Cystic sarcosis, either bovis or cellulose, present in pork or beef. So, contaminated pork or beef meat is the mode of transmission. So, when you take contaminated pork or beef meat, they contain what? Which form? Larval form. So, this larval form inside GIT, this larva will become adult. Adult undergo self fertilization to produce plenty of eggs. Eggs are released in feces, and the diagnostic form is nothing but egg. And you can differentiate in only in one way. They say that tinea solium sajanata, eggs are same, you cannot distinguish. Only difference is sajanata, the eggs are acid fast egg. Otherwise, they are same, morphologically they are same. Coming to cystic sarcosis, which is the agent of cystic sarcosis? Solium or sajanata or both? Only solium. Host, definitive host and intermediate host, both are men. Infective form, ulta, that is X. X are the infective form. Mode of transmission, contaminated food and water containing egg. This is the main mode of transmission. It has one more mode of transmission when the definitive host, intermediate host is same. That leads to what? Autoinfection. Autoinfection is a feature which is seen in intestinal, cystic sarcosis, which is not seen in intestinal tinnitus. So, following ingestion of egg inside your GIT, egg will develop into larva. Larva is cystic sarcosis cellulose, and this larva will penetrate GIT and will go and deposit in various organs. It will penetrate GIT and will go and deposit in various organ, cause a disease called as cystic sarcosis. The most common organ to be affected is CNS, followed by muscle and eyes. Neurocystic sarcosis is the most common site, and most common site in CNS. This is a controversial MCQ. Some books say subarachnoid says, whereas some say brain parenchyma. But according to my view, according to what I think, so many the recent articles they have given that subarachnoid space, now it is replacing brain parenchyma. Most common site in CNS. Of course, most common manifestation will be epilepsy. So, diagnosis, if you do a CT scan or MRI of brain or various organs, what you can see is you can detect the larval form in the form of cyst. They will be deposited as cyst like lesions that can be detected by CT scan and MRI. In intestinal tinnitus, what is the diagnostic form? Egg in stool. Here larva in various organs detected by CT scan MRI. Apart from that, it is also diagnosed by antibody detection. Antibody detection can be done by ELISA and Western blot. ELISA and Western blot can be done for antibody detection. They say that the cyst exists in four type of morphological forms. The larval form in the brain and in the other areas, they exist in four forms. Either they are vesicular cyst, necrotic cyst, nodular cyst or calcified cyst. Okay. And there is a criteria called as Del-Brutto's criteria. Del-Brutto's criteria is used for diagnosis of neurocysticercosis. It has taken various features into account, like ocular features, MRI features, then antibodies, epidemiological features, like that various parameters are taken into account. Del-Brutto's criteria. Drug of choice for neurocysticercosis, of course, surgery is the mainstay of treatment. Drug of choice, they say that albendazole can be given. Fine. Then tinea multipes. Tinea multipes is a very rare parasite infecting man. Here the definitive host is dog. Intermediate host is mainly animal, herbivorous animal, that like sheep, and rarely intermediate host is man. So here also the larval form is the diagnostic form. The larval form of tinea multiceps is called as coenurus. Coenurus is the larval form of tinea multiceps. It is deposited in CNS and the disease is called as coenurosis. It is deposited in CNS and the disease is called as coenurosis. The geographical distribution wise, they say that African countries like Kenya and Uganda, these are places where tinea multiceps cases have been reported. Echinococcus granulosis. Can you tell me which is the definitive host? Dog. Intermediate host, sheep is the usual, man is accidental, man is also the dead end. Infective form, egg. Transmission, don't say dog meat. Dog meat, we do not eat dog meat. Transmission is contaminated food and water containing egg. So when you ingest the egg, what happens is egg inside GIT will become larva. Larva is called as headed it cyst, and the larva will penetrate the GIT and go to various organ, and the most common organ affected is liver, followed by lungs, followed by brain. In liver again the most common site is posterior superior aspect of right liver, I mean right lobe. Okay. There is one more species is called as Echinococcus multilocularis, which is the agent of alveolar hydatid disease. Why it is called as alveolar hydatid disease? The reason is most common site is no, most common site is not lungs. Here also most common site is liver. They say that here the liver involvement is even more than that of granulocytes. 90% most common site is liver. Why it is called as alveolar hydatid disease? Because here the cyst has multiple locules. Here the hydatid cyst has multiple locules resembling alveoli. That is why called as alveolar hydatid disease. Okay. Two other species are the Echinococcus oligarthus and Echinococcus vogeli. They are the agent of polycystic hydatid disease. They are the agent of polycystic hydatid disease. Diagnosis: you can go for a hydatid fluid microscopy. You can detect the hydatid cyst structure can be detected, like they have a thick cyst wall. Trilayered cyst wall, pericyst, ectocyst and endocyst, like that three layer cyst wall is there, and I have just drawn the just a section of the cyst, otherwise the cyst will be like this. Okay. And to the cyst wall the brood capsules will be attached, brood capsules will be the future adult form, they will form the adult form in future, brood capsules. So hydatid fluid microscopy can be done. They say that acid fast stain can be done, because the hooklet of hydatid cyst are acid fast. Hooklet of hydatid cyst are acid fast. So acid fast stain also can be done. Fine. Apart from microscopy, you can go for caesonistis. This is a hypersensitivity type 1 skin test. Antibody detection. But they say that antibodies usually indicates past infection. Hence they are useful only for epidemiological purpose. What is more useful is antigen detection. This indicate recent infection. Ultrasound of abdomen can demonstrate water lily sign. That is the floating membrane of hydatid cyst in the abdomen. Floating membrane of hydatid cyst in the abdomen, water lily sign. Okay. They say that treatment of choice will be surgery. You can also go for a semi-conservative surgery, that is PAIR. Oh, what is PAIR? I asked in the college, one student answered that while surgery, one doctor and one nurse, they will together do the surgery. Yes, it is not like that. It is percutaneous aspiration, injection and re-aspiration of hydrated fluid. And albendazole is given, the drug of choice is albendazole, is given before and after the procedure. Albendazole is given before and after the procedure. Finish. Then difelobothrium latum, they say that it is the largest cystoid and it has got three hosts: definitive hosts, man; intermediate host, first intermediate host cyclops; second intermediate host fish. It is also called as fish tapeworm. It also has three larval form, L1, L2, L3, named as Coracidium, Procercoid larva and Pleurocercoid larva, which is the infective form. The infective form is the L3 form, that is Pleurocercoid larva, that is Pleurocercoid larva. So, the mode of transmission is ingestion of fish containing L3 larva, and its L3 larva inside GIT will become adult. Adult undergo fertilization to produce egg, and the eggs are having typical feature, that is the diagnostic form is operculated egg. And the main clinical feature is the adult form. They say that why it is called a difelobothrium, because the adult, the head end has two bothria or groove. Both the side, there are two grooves in the head, and this bothria is responsible for sucking vitamin B12 from the intestine, and that leads to megaloblastic anemia. And why it is called as latum? Latum means broader. They say that the segments, the each segments are broader than longer. The segments are broader than longer, hence it is called as latum. Hymenolepis nana. Hymenolepis nana, this is otherwise called as dwarf tapeworm. Here humans are the only host. It exists in three form, of course adult, egg and larva. Larva is called as cysticercoid. Here the infective form is egg, diagnostic form is also egg. So, when infective form and diagnostic form is same, what is seen? Autoinfection. The egg is described as, of course, it has a egg shell and three pair of hooklets. same like any other cystodec, but the differentiating feature is here both the shells are in both the membranes are filled with polar filament. Polar filament, and it is bile non-stain. Bile non-stain. Can you tell me the bile non-stain egg list? There is a very important code. The bile non-stain eggs are Nicator, Entrobius, Hnana, and Ankylostoma. Okay, so most of the eggs are bile stain or bile non-stain? Bile stain, and this is the exception. This is the exception. Trematode. Trematode, the examples are, trematodes are also called as flukes. It could be blood fluke, that is schistosoma, liver fluke, fasciola hepatica, GI fluke, fussy Leopsis busci, liver fluke. Other examples are also there, Opisthorchis and Clonorchis, Clonorchis and Opisthorchis, they are also liver fluke. Fasciola also liver fluke, fussy Leopsis busci, intestinal fluke. And lung fluke is Paragonimus. Paragonimus. Coming to the manifestations. Manifestation, they say that schistosoma hematobium it causes squamous cell carcinoma of bladder. Schistosoma mansoni and japonicum. Japonicum. They cause two important hypersensitivity reaction. They say that they cause a cutaneous type 1 hypersensitivity reaction called as Sercarial dermatitis. Or squamous itch. The same time they cause a hypersensitivity type 3 kind of serum sickness kind of infection called as Katayama fever. So, these are the important manifestations. Apart from that, they can cause dysentery also. Liver fluke, fasciola hepatica can cause hepatomegaly. Liver enlargement. Clonorchis and Opisthorchis can cause CA bile duct. CA bile duct. Fasciliopsis busci is a GI fluke, so you will have all sort of intestinal manifestation. And Paragonimus westermani, it is the agent of endemic hemoptysis. It is endemic in Manipur. endemic hemoptysis, and it is particularly endemic in Manipur. Okay, so let us discuss now life cycle. So this is in general their manifestations. Now let us focus on their life cycle. In general, the life cycle of trematodes is like this. They say that they have three hosts. Man is the definitive host, whereas intermediate host, the first intermediate host is snail. The second intermediate host is aquatic plant for F. How many of them have F? F for Fasciola and Fasciliopsis. Whereas second intermediate host is fish for Paragonimus, Clonorchis and Opisthorchis. Crabfish or crabfish. What is remaining? Schistosoma. Schistosoma, there is no second intermediate host. The infective form is metasarcarial larva. For all except schistosome, where the infective form is sarcarial larva. Similarly, mode of transmission, they say that ingestion of second intermediate host is the most common mode of transmission seen in most of the trematode, except, which is exception, schistosome. Here the mode of transmission is skin penetration by sarcarial larva. Okay, so this is how the life cycle you have to remember, and they say that the diagnostic form is egg. Only thing is the specimen is different. For example, schistosoma hematobium, egg is detected in urine, whereas paragonimus in sputum, whereas most other trematode it is detected in feces. The specimen is different, otherwise egg in sputum is the most diagnostic form. The description of egg is all trematode they have operculated egg. Operculated egg in most of the trematode except schistosoma. Schistosoma, the eggs are non-operculated. Instead of operculum, they have a spine, and based on the spine you can locate. Based on the spine you can locate. For example, schistosoma hematobium has a terminal spine. Hematobium has a terminal spine. Mansoni has a lateral spine. And Japonicum has a rudimentary lateral spine. Rudimentary lateral spine. So, this is how you have to speciate. This is how the three important schistosoma species can be differentiated from each other. drug of choice for all trematode infection, the drug of choice is praziquantel. Except fasciola hepatica, where the drug of choice is albendazole. Okay, so this is all about trematodes, can be classified as intestinal nematode and somatic or tissue nematode. Intestinal nematode, again they are either small intestine or large intestine. Small intestine are the major nematodes like Ascaris, hookworm, Strongyloides. Hookworm means it could be either ankylostoma or Nicator. Large intestine, you have Enterobius and Trichuris. Somatic nematodes examples are all filarial nematodes, then Trichinella spiralis and Dracunculus. Dracunculus. You can also classify the nematodes based on what will be produced after fertilization. Accordingly, they are classified as oviparous, viviparous and ovoviviparous. Oviparous, I mean viviparous, after fertilization directly larva is produced, there is no egg stays at all in viviparous. All somatic nematodes are example of viviparous. Oviparous, after fertilization egg will be produced, eggs are converted to larva very soon, mainly in the intestine itself. Whereas ovoviviparous, eggs will be produced. One second, there is a mistake. Oviparous, eggs will be produced, eggs will be converted to larva after long time, mainly in the environment, soil. Whereas ovoviviparous, eggs are produced, they will become larva very soon in the GIT itself. All somatic nematodes are viviparous, all intestinal nematodes are oviparous except Strongyloides, which is an example of ovoviviparous. So, which is the diagnostic form for Strongyloides? Egg or larva? Larva. Others? Egg. So, let us discuss the life cycle. Life cycle of T we will discuss together. Cycle we will discuss. T stands for Trichuris, Enterobius and Ascaris. All these three, why are discussing together? Because the mode of transmission is oral, infective form is same, that is embryonated egg. So, when you take embryonated egg in the GIT, egg will become larva, larva gradually will become adult, adults are male and female, they undergo cross fertilization to produce egg. And for Trichuris and Ascaris, eggs are of course initially unembryonated, eggs are initially immature. that is unembryonated. And for Trichuris and Ascaris, the unembryonated eggs are only diagnostic form. They will become embryonated egg only in the environment. What is remaining? Entrobius. For Entrobius, the unembryonated egg will become embryonated egg in the GIT itself. So, what is released? Embryonated, actually embryonated egg will not be released in feces, they are usually present in the perianal skin. Perianal swabs you have to take, because they will be crawling in the perianal region. So, you have to take a perianal swabs where you will get embryonated egg as the diagnostic form. And because embryonated egg is a diagnostic form, embryonated egg is also the infective form for Entrobius. That is the reason by Entrobius there is one more mode of transmission, that is autoinfection. Autoinfection is seen in Entrobius because the diagnostic form and the infective form is same. So, the by the contaminated fingers the same form can be again be passed. So, this is a common life cycle for all three. And in Ascaris, one step is extra. They say that in Ascaris, the larva penetrate the GIT. In Ascaris, one step is extra. The larva penetrate the GIT and they through the GI vessel, they reach lungs, and from lungs by the swallowing of sputum again they come back. From lungs by the swallowing of sputum again they come back to GIT. So, the pulmonary phase is extra for Ascaris, and that is why you have low flux pneumonia in Ascaris. Fine. Then let us discuss little bit individual. Trichuris, also called as weep worm, and the main clinical why it is called as weep worm, because the adult worm is whip shaped. Adult female worm is whip shaped, having a handle and a whip, and because it is whip shaped, it can cause large intestinal erosion. And the large intestinal erosion lead to the main clinical feature is Trichuris dysentery. Dysentery will be produced. Diagnostic form, unembryonated egg. And the description is like this: barrel shaped, having two mucus plug. And of course, bile stained, and initially they are unembryonated egg which are released in feces. Okay. Entrobius. Entrobius is also called as pinworm or threadworm. They are thread set, very small, small structure. And this adult female of Entrobius, it crawls in the perianal region, especially in the night time, that leads to nocturnal pruritus ani. And the specimen of choice is perianal swab, either by a cellophane tap or by specialized swab called as NIH swab, NIH, that is National Institute of Health swab, is a specialized swab designed to collect perianal swab for Entrobius. Which is a diagnostic form? Diagnostic form is embryonated egg, And the description is, it is plano convex, having a larva inside, and it is bilonstein. Plano convex, it is embryonated. Embryonated means what? Having a larva inside. And don't forget it, it is bilonstein. One side is plain, one side is convex, hence it is called as plano convex. Ascaris, Ascaris also called as roundworm, and Ascaris of course is one of the longer worm, one of the longest worm infecting man, and it is so long that of course apart from the other GI symptom, non-specific GI symptom, because of the length it can twist and can cause intestinal obstruction. Sometimes even intussusception. All these are specific complications seen in Ascaris. And don't forget, it has a pulmonary face. Yes or no? Pulmonary face can cause low flux pneumonia, which is a diagnostic form. Ascaris, the diagnostic form is unembryonated egg. The unembryonated egg of Ascaris is of two types, fertilized, unfertilized. Why this fertilized, unfertilized word we use only for Ascaris? The thing is, Ascaris is one of the longest worm. Other worms are not that long, they are very small, small. So, Ascaris female worm is so long that it will have lakhs of egg inside, and all the eggs not necessarily will be fertilizing with the male partner. So, there is every chance that many eggs without fertilizing they may be released in feces. That usually do not happen with others. Others usually fertilized egg only will be released. Ascaris, there is two kind of egg, fertilized egg will be released also, unfertilized egg also will be released. So, fertilized egg is, the description of fertilized egg is round to oval, and it has got a very thick albumin coat. Round to oval and thick albumin coat. Okay, round to oval, and it has a very thick albumin coat. And it floats on saturated salt solution. Unfertilized egg is rectangular and elongated, and the albumin coat is very thin. The albumin coat is very thin, and it does not float on saturated salt solution. F for F, fertilized egg floats, unfertilized egg does not float on saturated salt solution. Okay, so this is all about Ascaris. Let us now discuss about the other two important intestinal nematode, that is Strongyloides and hookworm. Why to discuss Strongyloides and hookworm together is, Strongyloides and hookworm, the infective form is L3 larva. L3 larva or filariform larva. Mode of transmission is skin penetration. So, when the L3 larva penetrates the skin, comes to GIT, inside GIT, L3 larva will become adult. Adult will be differentiated to at least for hookworm, adult will be differentiated to adult male and female. They undergo cross fertilization to produce eggs. Eggs are initially unembryonated, and the unembryonated eggs are diagnostic form for hookworm. And this unembryonated egg in the environment will become embryonated egg. Embryonated egg will hatch out to form L1, that will become L2 and finally will become L3, and L3 is the what? Infective form. In contrast, Strongyloides, what happens is Strongyloides in human intestine, they say that only adult female will be there. Adult males, they do not exist in human intestine, only adult females will be there. So, if there is only female, then there is no fertilization. There is no fertilization, there is no egg. No, fertilization is not there, but Strongyloides has a power of producing egg without fertilization also by a asexual reproduction called as parthenogenesis. And this, because of that, eggs are produced. That means what? Eggs are the diagnostic form or not? No. Strongyloides is example of OVOVV or OVOVV. So, if it is OVOVviparous, that means eggs will become soon larva inside the human intestine, and L1 is the diagnostic form. L1 is called as rhabdidiform larva. L1 is called as rhabdidiform larva. And they say that this L1 in the environment will become L2 and L3, then L3 is the infective form. This is called as direct environmental cycle. There is an indirect environmental cycle also, in which they say that L1 will become L2, L3, then adult male and female, they undergo fertilization to produce egg. Egg will hatch out to become L1, then L2, then L3. This is called as indirect environmental cycle. So, only in the indirect cycle males are there, otherwise Strongyloides males are the most useless living structures of the world. They are the most neglected. Okay. So, that is all. So, that is all is a life cycle, or something else is there? Something else is still there. They say that Strongyloides auto infection is seen. How auto infection is seen? They say that L1, which is a diagnostic form, when they are found in small intestine, I mean in the large intestine, they themselves can become L2 and L3 in the intestine itself. If L1 will become L2 and L3 in the intestine itself, then L3 being the infective form, it can cause endogenous auto infection by reverse peristalsis. It can cause endogenous auto infection by reverse peristalsis. If that happens, then in no matter of time, you will have a huge larval load. You will have a huge larval load. They say that by reverse peristalsis, L3 will be formed, which will multiply to release a huge larval load. Such a huge larval load can penetrate GIT and goes to various organ to cause infection called as hyperinfection syndrome, or disseminated strongyloidiasis. Hyperinfection syndrome or disseminated strongyloidiasis. and mainly CNS is affected. Mainly CNS is affected, and this particular syndrome is common in HIV and HTLV-1 infected people. Hyperinfection syndrome is common in HIV and HTLV-1 infected people. So, this is all about the life cycle of strongyloidosis and hookworm. And hookworm, they sometimes ask how to diagnose the egg. Hookworm will produce an unembryonated egg, which is described as oval. Oval by non-stain, and initially the segmented ovum, the ovum is segmented. Segmented ovum. Segmented ovum. Okay. And regarding the clinical manifestation, hookworm, it enters through skin penetration. So, at skin penetration site, you will have local lesion like ground itch and serpentine ulcer. Whereas in GI, of course, iron deficiency anemia, because it sucks blood from the intestine, as well as iron deficiency anemia, as well as other GI manifestation will be there. Non-specific manifestation also will be there, but iron deficiency anemia is the specific manifestation. Fine. So, this is all about hookworm and strongyloidosis. Then filarial nematode. Filarial nematode examples, yes, Eucheria bancrofti, Brugia malai and Brugia timori, then Loa Loa, Onchocerca volvulus and Mansonella streptocerca, Mansonella. So, these are the various filarial nematodes. They say that filarial nematodes, they have a specific habitat. They say that the microfilaria means it is the L1 form. The L1 form of the parasite is called as a microfilaria. The microfilaria comes to the blood only at a particular period of time. So, this is called as habitat or periodicity of the parasite. Eucheria bancrofti and Brugia malai are nocturnal in habitat. They are nocturnal in habitat. Loa Loa nocturnal means they will come to the blood in the night time. Loa Loa is diurnal, that is daytime it will come to the blood. Onchocerca and Mansonella, they are non-periodic. Regarding the vector, Eucheria bancrofti, the routine vector is Culex, which is nocturnal, whereas the strains that are transmitted by Aedes, those strains are sub-periodic in habitat. They say that Eucheria bancrofti can be transmitted by Culex, Aedes as well as Anopheles. All three can transmit Ujjayi bankruptcy. Most common is of course Culex fatigans is most common. But the Aedes infected strains, the habitat is subperiodic. Subperiodic means they will come to the peripheral blood in late evening. And Aedes infected strains are endemic in Andamans. Endemic in Andamans. Okay. Brugia malai is transmitted by Mansonella and Anopheles. Most commonly, Mansonella followed by Anopheles. I mean, not Mansonella, Mansonia. Transmitted by the vector, the mosquito Mansonia, followed by Anopheles. Brugia timori is transmitted by a species of Anopheles called as Anopheles barbirostris, and this timori is endemic only in the Timori island of Indonesia. The Timori island is located in Indonesia, only in that particular island this is seen. Onchocerca volvulus, the vector is black fly. Black flies are the genus Simulium. Mansonella midges is the common name, whereas the generic name is Culicoides. Okay, so this is the vectors what you need to remember, very very important table. And they say that the microfilaria of some of them will have a sheath, outer covering. If this is a microfilaria, then some of them will have a outer covering. This it is covered by a sheath, not all, but some of them there is a outer sheath. So peripheral sheath will be present is Eucheria, Brugia and Loa Loa. Eucheria, Brugia and Loa Loa, the microfilaria is sheath microfilaria, whereas Onchocerca and Mansonella are, they do not have sheath. Okay, so this is how the difference. Next is how the life cycle occurs. Life cycle, they say that L3 form or the filary form larva is the infective form, transmitted by mosquito bite. So the L3 form larva will be deposited on skin. Through skin it will enter into local lymphatics, and through local lymphatics it will go to the regional lymph node. So when they go to lymph node, inside the lymph node the L3 larva will become adult. Adult male and female, they undergo fertilization to produce no egg. They are viviparous. No, viviparous means directly L1 will be produced. L1 are also called as microfilaria. So this L1, otherwise it will be residing in the lymphatics. Most of the part of the day it will be residing in the lymphatics, except at certain part it will come to the peripheral blood. Peripheral blood, it will come only based upon the periodicity of the parasite. Nocturnal parasites will come in the daytime, night time. Diurnal parasites will come in the daytime. Subperiodic strains will come to the peripheral blood in late evening. So this is all about the periodicity. And they say that the pathogenic form is nothing but adult female, not the microfilaria. Adult females are the pathogenic form. They multiply in the lymph node and that lead to lymph node obstruction, lymph adenitis, lymphangitis. So, these are the various pathological features. This occurs because of the adult female, not because of microfilaria. And disease can be classified into four stages: endemic, normal. These are the normal individual in endemic area, asymptomatic filariasis. There is no symptom, but they will have microfilaria will be positive in blood. Then acute filariasis, they are symptomatic patient plus microfilaria will be positive. Symptomatic like fever, as I told you, edema, lymphedema, then lymphangitis, lymph adenitis, dermatolymphangitis, skin infection will be there. All these are various features of acute filariasis, and please remember microfilaria will be positive in blood, followed by chronic filariasis. Chronic filariasis occurs long after, they say that 10 to 20 years later the acute filariasis, and here the pathogenesis is due to a severe obstruction. And the severe obstruction leads to the lymphatic vessels will be seriously obstructed, occluded. The occlusion of the lymphatic vessel lead to various manifestation like chyluria, hydrocele, elephantiasis, granuloma of the female breast. So, all these are specific manifestation of chronic filariasis. Lymphatic varices, one more is lymphatic varices. And please remember, chronic filariasis also microfilaria will be mostly, it will be negative in blood. Microfilaria will be mostly, it will be negative in blood. So, in contrast to lymphatic filariasis, there is one more form of filariasis called as classical filariasis. I mean, lymphatic filariasis is otherwise called as classical filariasis. One more variety is there, which is called as occult filariasis. What is the difference? Lymphatic filariasis, the pathogenic form is adult female, whereas the diagnostic form is microfilaria in blood. Most of the pathology takes place in lymphatics. In contrast, occult filariasis is a condition, it is a hypersensitive reaction to microfilaria antigen. The pathogenesis is due to a hypersensitive reaction to microfilarial antigen. In contrast, the microfilaria will be absent in blood. Organ will be affected, will be most common organ will be lung, where it is called as tropical pulmonary eosinophilia. And here diagnosis is done by hyper IgE and eosinophilia. These two are the diagnostic feature. Fine. So, now lab diagnosis. Again you can go for a peripheral blood microscopy. Based upon the timing based on the habitat the blood is collected. For example, natural parasite blood is collected between 10 pm to 4 am. Subperiodic strains, the blood is collected between 8 pm to 10 pm. Diurnal will be daytime, maybe 2 to 6 pm. But how you can avoid this timing? You want to collect at your own time, not at the time when the parasite will come. Then you can do a test called as DEC provocation test. You have to provoke the parasite to come to the blood. DEC provocation test is give a tablet of DEC to the patient, the microfilaria will dance and will come to the blood within half an hour. So, this is called as DEC provocation test. This can be done to collect the blood even during the daytime. So, once you collect the blood, if you do a peripheral blood smear, then it is important to differentiate between microfilaria of Wuchereria bancrofti and Brugia malai. They say that Wuchereria bancrofti the microfilaria, of course, it is sheath, it will have an outer sheath. Outer sheath will be there, and inside the nucleus will be there. They say that inside nucleus, the inside of the microfilaria, it is filled with nucleus. So, the identifying feature is the tail end. The tail end is pointed, you can see the tail end is pointed and it is free of nuclei. Whereas, Brugia malai is also sheathed, both are sheathed, but the tail end is blunt. Will be like this, the tail end is blunt and the nucleus are extended till the tail tip. Tail end is blunt with nuclei extended till the tail tip. Okay. So, this is how you can differentiate. If the parasite density is less, in blood, then you can follow centrifuge techniques, that is concentration, blood concentration is done, or even QBC also is followed, quantitative Buffy coat examination, what you do for malaria parasite, that also can be followed here. Fine. So, this is all about the peripheral blood microscopy. Next is antibody detection. Various methods are available like ELISA, immunofluorescence assay, etcetera, but problem is antibodies are cross reactive. And they cannot differentiate between recent and past infection. In contrast, antigen detection is very popular. Antigen detection is specific, as well as it can differentiate between recent and past. Antigens can be detected even during daytime. There are two antigen detection methods are available. One is ELISA detecting AD12 antigen. And one more ELISA method is available which detects OG4C3 antigen. So these are the three antigen, two antigen detection methods are available. PCR also you can do. PCR is highly sensitive. X-ray and other imaging methods can be done. Ultrasound and X-ray. Ultrasound, if you do, then you can see the filarial dense sign in scrotum. Okay. Next is drug of choice. They say that DEC is a drug of choice, diethyl carbamazine. In India, DEC plus albendazole based regimens are given, whereas African countries DEC plus ivermectin based regimens are given. And at this context, I want to tell that DEC act on both microfilaria and adult, whereas ivermectin acts only on microfilaria. Then the other parasites, filarial parasites, like for example Brugia, can you tell me what is the vector? Brugia, the vector is Mansonia followed by Anopheles. Okay, mostly the strains are nocturnal. Rarely sub-periodic strains are there, and they are transmitted from monkeys. They are zoonotic strains transmitted from monkeys by Mansonia vector. And don't forget that for the survival of the Mansonia, Pistia plants are important. Pistia plants are important for the survival of Mansonia vector. So, in the filariasis eradication program, removal of Pistia plant is one of the strategy. Because they are important for the survival of Mansonia vector. Okay. Then clinically, Brugia malai infection is almost same as Eucheria bancrofti infection. Only difference is here only leg below the knee is involved. Okay. The elephantiasis occurs only below the knee. There is no genital involvement. That is, there is no hydrocele. Okay, so acute adrenal lymphangitis is the most common manifestation. Okay, so this is all about Brugia malai, and Brugia timori I have already told. It is endemic in the Timori Island of Indonesia. It is the only place where it is seen. A bit about Loa Loa and Onkosarka. Loa Loa is the agent of Calabar swelling. Whereas Onkosarka bulbulus is endemic in Africa. And it causes various manifestation like dermatitis, leopard skin, All these are cutaneous manifestation. Nodule called as onchosarcoma. Apart from that, ocular manifestation, skin manifestation will be all this. Ocular manifestation is, it causes river blindness. And they say that the lymph nodes will be hanging, and this particular sign is called as hanging groin. The lymph node will be hanging from the groin region, I mean it will be hang from the groin region, and this particular sign is called as hanging groin. Okay, diagnosis is of course detection of microfilaria in skin specimen, and here remember the skin specimens are collected by a method what we follow for leprosy, that is slit skin smear. Slit skin smear is the method to collect the skin specimen what you follow in leprosy, and microfilaria can be seen. And apart from that, the skin test called as Mazzotti skin test, or which is also called as DC patch test, the other name. Don't forget the drug of choice is ivermectin. Africa, so ivermectin. Okay, so that finishes a parasitology.